In the year 753 BC, on the fringes of the civilized world, the city of Rome was founded by the legendary brothers, Romulus and Remus. Over the next 2.5 centuries, Rome's kings would contend with the other powers on the Italian peninsula. In the south, there were the dynamic and innovative Greek colonies. The north was dominated by the industrious Etruscan civilization, which would eventually fall prey to invading Gauls from modern-day France, and the rise of Rome. In the center of Italy, this was populated by numerous squabbling tribes. Twin brothers Romulus and Remus disagreed on the exact site for building the city, and their petty squabbling ended with Romulus killing Remus. As you might imagine, it is difficult to attract settlers if you go out and try to found a city. So Romulus offered asylum to criminals, runaway slaves, the dispossessed, those on the down and out, vagabonds, and villains of all kinds. Offering a new beginning was so attractive that the city began to rapidly expand from its founding, with just one major problem cropping up. The entire city's population was almost exclusively male. They would have no future without a next generation, so they successfully executed a plan in which they invited a rival, the Sabines, over to a big party, open bar all night, all you can drink. The Romans pretended to get drunk, and when the Sabines all blacked out or passed out, they went and stole all the single ladies from the Sabines and brought them back to Rome. This triggered a war, as you might imagine. Legend has it that the Sabine woman rushed out in the middle of the vicious battle, stating that they did not wish to be widowed and fatherless. Afterwards, a negotiated peace was made, where the Romans and the Sabines would be united into one kingdom, ruled jointly by Romulus and Titus Tatius, king of the Sabines. After Titus died, Romulus ruled a combined kingdom alone. After Romulus died, the Sabines contended that it would only be fair for the next king of Rome to be a Sabine, since they had all lived under a Roman king for some time. The Romans agreed, but only if they could vote for which Sabine was to lead them. So Numa, the son-in-law of Titus Tatius, was elected king of Rome. He is credited with the establishment of the Roman religion and a vast assortment of rituals followed by the Romans for centuries to come. His reign was long and peaceful. He was followed by the Latin king, Tullus Hostilius, whose reign was marked by near constant warfare with Rome's neighbors, taking the nearby city of Alba Longa. Rome would again switch back to electing a Sabine king, the grandson of Numa. By this point, the Sabines and the Romans had nearly been fully assimilated. Ancus Marcius was a builder and constructed Rome's first aqueducts and the port city of Ostia, giving Rome access to the Mediterranean Sea. During his prosperous reign, one of the many immigrants to enter Rome was called Lucamo. He was the son of a Greek Corinthian who had married an Etruscan woman. Because he was considered an outsider, they were shunned by the Etruscan elite, so he sought a new beginning in Rome. He changed his name to Lucius Tarquin after the Etruscan city that he came from. He would do well in Rome and would be known as a generous man who helped those in need and rendered assistance to anyone who asked for it. The king became such great friends with Tarquin that he made him guardian over his two sons. When Ancus died, Tarquin suggested the king's sons go on a hunting trip for a few days while he took care of things, and he did. With the sons gone, Tarquin immediately proposed himself as election for king of Rome. He had a reputation for generosity and fair dealing. The sons would feel betrayed and disrespected upon seeing Tarquin's election as king of Rome and would leave the city. They would quietly watch and despise Tarquin's long and prosperous reign. During his 38th year, they hired two assassins to pretend to have a legal dispute for the king to hear. While one started to explain an elaborate and enthralling story, the other walked behind Tarquin and struck him with an axe, instantly killing him. The sons of Ancus had hoped to wage war on Rome following the chaos of the king's death, but Tarquin's wife came out and assured everyone it was merely a flesh wound and the king would recover shortly. The queen's son-in-law, Servius Tullus, was made king of Rome in secret, and by the time everyone realized that he had been king, it had already been some time and people had become accustomed to his rule and no chaos ensued. The origins of Servius Tullus are obscured, but some believe him to either be an Etruscan or a freed slave, or both. During his reign, he would carry out the first census in world history, where every man, woman, and child would be tabulated into clearly defined categories, each clearly delineated into their respective obligations to the Roman state. His daughter would marry the grandson of the murdered King Tarquin, also named Tarquin. The two plotted a coup d'etat. He dressed in royal regalia and threw the aging king out of the Senate building. While returning home, he was murdered by assassins, and legend has it that his daughter's carriage trampled over her father's body while leaving the Senate house. Tarquin the Proud, as he would be known, was an authoritarian ruler. He would purge the Roman aristocracy of potential enemies, and he would also make Rome the head of the Latin League of Tribes, and defeated many of her local enemies. Those not engaged in warfare would be put to work, building a massive temple of Jupiter, which would be the center of Roman religion over the next 1,000 years, and the city's great sewers, which allowed the city to grow ever larger. His downfall would be caused by his son Sextus, who was obsessed with the beautiful Lucretia. After refusing his advances, he forced himself on her. Lucretia would publicly denounce the Tarquins for the assault and demand vengeance. While the crowd was determining whether they should act or not, Lucretia took a knife she had concealed on herself and stabbed herself in the chest. One bystander, named Brutus, would whip the crowd into such fervor and fury that they ran the Tarquins out of the city. The Romans vowed never to have a king again, and created the world's first republic. But Tarquin was not done yet. Leading a massive army comprised of a coalition of Etruscan kings, he attempted to take Rome back. The bloody campaign saw his son and Brutus die. However, the Republic survived. He tried one last time to take Rome, this time turning the members of the Latin League against Rome, yet he failed again. So ended the Roman Age of Kings. It lasted for 244 years and had seen Rome rise from a quasi-bandit encampment to the world's first republic, standing amongst the foremost powers of Italy. Those Gauls I mentioned earlier? They would sack Rome in 390 BC, burning its histories of this period. Thus, the Age of Kings is a mixture of oral tradition, confused folk memories, myths, and some outright lies cobbled together by later Republican Romans. Don't forget to smash the like button, hit subscribe, and ring the bell icon to get notifications every time I make a new video. That really motivates me to keep making new content. And if you want to be like Jody Ballas, Alberto Morpheus, Greiger, Yenyo, and Artem, head over to Patreon and help support this channel. Starting at just $1 a month, or for $3, you can get your name in every episode. Thank you guys are awesome for me to the end of the video.